Welcome back to Let's Play Disco Elysium Blind. I'm Amethyst Lunatari. We're here, finally ready to ask Lillian the Net Picker if we can use her boat. I believe it's would be this one. Oh wait, we got a thing here. You should ask the owner before you take this boat to the island. No kidding. Yeah, we'll just hop on in and say bye.
Officer, what happened? You're wounded. Why are you wounded? You look terrible.
Right, I think she's the only one we haven't checked in on since the shootout. And, yeah, because we're hitting her last, because we're also going to ask her to take the boat across the island. We're pretty much done around with everything here, so... Conceptualization says, you're not limping, you're you. Authority says, she sounds almost disappointed with you, reprimanding you for falling and hurting your knee. It was pretty badass. I live in the between before life and death. You seem angry. Why?
Look at you. You can barely walk.
Didn't get shot like in the side and the thigh? Got shot in the foot? It's nothing.
Doesn't look like nothing. Looks like you got banged up real good. What happened to you anyway? We heard gunshots from the town. They were closer than usual.
Closer than usual. Maybe you're starting to put two and two together, Lillian.
There was an exchange of fire on the Rue de Saint-Guilaine. It's nothing to be worried about, madame.
Guilaine. Rue de Saint-Guilaine. I also got shot in the chest.
That's nothing to brag about, officer.
It's not serious. He'd be okay.
Endurance says, you feel the ligament move on your left shoulder and a small, warm drip of blood. It's nothing. You should see the other guys. Two dead, one in the hospital.
So you're a killer. That's good, I guess. I guess. Better than being dead.
She nods solemnly. I'm not a killer. I'm a cop.
Aye, I guess you are. I understand. That's how it goes.
She nods. I have a question for you.
Of course. Can I help you with something?
Still can't ask her on that date. Oh well. We need to get to that island over there? That won't be a problem. It's wind still. And the tar just dried. She points to her skiff next to the jetty. We got 2 days of relative sunshine ahead. What's on that island? I saw some kind of ruins through the binoculars. Used to be some kind of fortification there before the war, for the communards. An anti-aircraft gun, I think. Bombed to bits in the landing. I haven't been there myself. Always steer clear of it. Rhetoric says, hasn't been there herself. Who has then? Who has then, if not you? My husband used to drink there. Him and his drinking buddies. Always seemed like a bad place to drink to me. People died there during the landing. You know, my mother told me. Encyclopedia says, this must be one of the many fortifications that was used in the dying days of the revolution against coalition forces before they took this city. She looks around. The kids sometimes go there too. I know they do. On rafts. I tell them not to, but they bring back old bullet casings and such. Which kids? The twins. She points to the two kids playing on the concrete yard. God forbid they bring the girl along on some rickety barge. Those kids? That would look like they were 8 years old or something? What do they do? Swim across or they take your boat? Can we maybe ask your twins about that place before we go? Kim asks. Would that be alright? Be my guest. She looks at the boys. They have a strange way of talking. She even getting anything useful out of them. I seldom do. Is there anything I should know about getting there? Well, most of it's sunken, underwater. That means concrete underwater. Cut your boat if you're not careful. Be sure to enter from the south side. Water's deep there. South side, got it. interfacing says, "Aye, aye, Captain." Well, I need to ask the twins, but I can't leave here yet. Can we borrow your boat? If you promise to bring it back, and no scraping the hull, I just got it nice and yellow, and no drinking on the boat. Her eyes narrow, and no joyriding either. Of course, ma'am, Kim says. It's only for a day or two. Official police business. Aye, she nods. What if I want a rock? See, that makes me not want to lend you my skiff. On a boat, rocking leads to capsizing. That there's an absolutely 100% rock-free skiff. You got that? Thank you. Oh. Thank you. We'll use your skiff to get there, then. She nods. Please be conservative with the fuel, will you? I just filled her up, but it's a small tank. Talk to the twins. Lillian mentioned they might have been there on a raft. The twins are on the concrete yard in the middle of the village. Use the net picker skiff on the jetty and go to the island. Okay. Alright. Let's go ask them. We haven't been able to get anything useful out of them until now. We'll see how. We'll see if we can now. The scruffy-haired little boy kicks a stone while the other watches him do it. Yeah, I never told them children are stupid. Okay, kids, you've been to that island, right? On that island? The one who's busy kicking his stone points to the bay? Yes, that one. I need to know what's there. That's, nothing? The boy pauses to think with his finger in his mouth. It's just a sea fort and some plants. You can take a raft there. It's great. Okay, they use a raft. The other twin says, and, the other one butts in, we make a fire. Mm-hmm, his brother nods. Gather the sticks for the fire, and bullets. Or, not real bullets, empty bullets. Logic says, bullet shells? There are a lot of them left over from the war, but this could be important. Wait, you mean shells? I don't know what those are. What then? There are lights. The fire guy comes and asks us to put the fire out. Redrick says, they must mean a human being on that island, but it's cut off. Someone lives on the island? No, the boy answers, shaking his head vehemently. His brother looks at him, then at you. Yes, he says. The lieutenant raises his eyebrows and whips out his notebook. Let's go with yes. Why is he the fire guy? Because... The boy pauses to think. Because he asks us to put the fire out, the other explains. Why does he ask you to put the fire out? I don't know. He doesn't like it. He doesn't like people to be there. You shouldn't go. So, obviously we're leading towards the killer sniper person being on the island. The fire... He probably wants put out because he doesn't want to raise attention to the place. Yes, the other one adds laconically, standing with his hands glued to his side like a little tin soldier. Savoir Faire says, because he doesn't want to be found. Smoke traces. Exactly. You mentioned something about lights? One of them. It's hard to tell which one now starts. I don't know. Did you mean there are electrical lights? Kim points to the street light. Yes. The boy looks at his toes. Is there anything else you can tell me about this guy? Age? Does he live there? No, he doesn't live there. I don't think. No, he lives there, the other nods. He's been there twice. Two times. Huh. The first one pauses to think, then comes to some kind of conclusion. He doesn't live there. He isn't there sometimes. Huh. Anything else? Kim asks. What does this guy look like? I don't know. They say almost in unison. How come? We ran. He just yelled we shouldn't be there. Your father used to go to that island too, didn't he? Our father killed himself. Don't say that. He didn't. His brother punches him. The boy's eyes well up like he's about to start crying. Your father did not kill himself. I don't know. The boy who made the claim finds himself unsure of it. He looks around. The other watches him, brows knitted. It doesn't even have anything to do with this, you. Father isn't the fire guy. Logic says the two things are unconnected. Your question didn't make sense. Sorry. is that all you know? Is there anything more you can tell me about the island? There's a... the boy says, rubbing his eyes. It's clear that he has no intention of finishing the sentence. Lights? Fire guy? The lieutenant looks at you. We should check up on that island. We're going to. Anyway, we're done with that one. Still so weird seeing such a small amount of quests in there. Right, well, we're just gonna go ahead and take the boat, right? She already gave us the go-ahead. A skiff with a small steering engine in the back floats on the calm mirror of the sea. Its two seats are empty. Not for long, they're not. Inland Empire says, once you get in, that's it. One pull of the starter handle and you're off into the bay. A strange trepidation comes over you. Are you sure you want to go now? Savoir Faire says, have you made all the necessary preparations? Closed all your accounts? Logic says, remember what the net picker said. It's a small tank. You won't be going back and forth on this. I'll hold the boombox. Now let's not rock out. Let's get in and ride to the island. I've done everything there is to do. That I know of. I gotta stand there like that. So we're not coming back this way. Are we swimming? Should we have grabbed some oars or something? Yeah, I was gonna say we should turn. It will last forever. We got stairs. The location of the sniper there. entrance to something. It looks like a door to the right. Maybe you're one doorway. There's another, like some kind of structure up the top. The boat comes to a slow stop. Kim turns the engine off. Then there's silence. In the silence, perception says, a sputter of wings, a flock of quails takes off in the distance. Let's go, Kim whispers. Test complete. Getting to the island. If we're ever going to find out where that is. Dolores Day figurine. A makeshift bridge. The bombs were powerful enough to break the four foundation. The rusted chain trails off into the ocean. Interfacing says the chain trails off into the ocean, connecting the island to the supply depot on the coast. Hey Kim, this leads to the depot in Land's End. The lieutenant looks at the mechanism overhead. Ah, yes. So it seems. What do you think it was used for? For bringing munitions to the island, maybe? And supplies. You could also lock the bay when you raise the chain. Visual calculus says, as a defensive measure, locking off that side of the bay. Lock it from whom? I guess invaders? From enemies. He looks up ahead. Enemies of the commune of Revachol. This sea fort was a revolutionary fortification, I believe. Alright, well, where do we go first? I run up here? The location of the sniper? Go over there. Attention! Inflammable! Wait. There's a lingering trace of mazout in the air. Some fuel has leaked out of the barrel. Black. Viscous. We go in there. Before I go in anywhere, I'm going to explore the whole place outside. This barrel says ICM. You see a star with little specks in it. Encyclopedia says ICM. This feels familiar somehow. Oh, something encyclopedia doesn't know. Sounds like RCM. Maybe inter-isolary citizens militia? Kim, what is the ICM? Oh, close. Insulindian Citizens Militia. It's the official name of the Communard's army, the Black and White Army of the Revolution. Encyclopedia says sounds an awful lot like RCM. It sounds like Revachol Citizens Militia. It does. Why? The RCM may descend from the ICM. May? It's impossible to say. He looks towards the darkened doorway. It was chaos after the war. The name was good for getting people to join us. Revachol West was mostly workers and criminals. Rhetoric says, nice political thoughts rush through your neocortex. Endurance says, a mediocre athlete would pant from dragging around his body on a busted crutch. But not you. You're thinking about politics with blood dripping down your thigh. Now, the funny thing is, I was, editing my video, going through everything, where Ruby says we arrived here with two men and a woman? And a woman, do you believe? They were all locked and loaded. The woman was the only one in a uniform. It sounds like the three mercenaries that we ended up killing, who almost killed us, but they did not mention... They didn't seem to recognize Harry at all. They didn't let on to anything. What I'm hearing is, we descend from the glorious Revolutionary Army. There were all sorts of groups and group huskles back then. It doesn't really matter. He bows to inspect the barrel. A white star, pointing to the star on the label. No, he looks at it. An upside-down star. Encyclopedia says, with its horns in the sky, the symbol of the commune. Are those speck stars, too? No, that's the uninhabited archipelago. Encyclopedia says, a DeLorean-era symbol of Insulind, known as the Face in the Sea. Looks old. What's it still doing here? After, he thinks, 44 years? That's not nearly enough to hide what happened here, Lieutenant Euphrator. One of these barrels was still leaking fuel, as you saw. The city is full of old things like this. Old bullets, guns, fuel. Warm blood trickles down your armpit. The ligature is off. It's nothing. The little birch from the coin-operated viewer, still holding on. No way to get up there. The stairs are gone. Just look around before I go in anywhere. These tires are falling apart. They're at least 50 years old. Tires, tears. Oh, wait. Oh, I can't go that way. Ah. There's a, like, a doorway over there. I cannot go. Alright, never mind. I guess we're just going through one of these doors. Well, actually, there's only one. Yeah, it's just this. Alright. What's that? Maybe we come out that way. Maybe we might come out that way. Because we can't get down there. Alright, let's check it out. This once was an armament rest. Twin cannons were attached here. Medium distance, large caliber. Careful, these stairs have collapsed. Books, mostly fantastique and historical fiction. Dishes stained with sauce and fire. A survivor's kitchen. You see candles planted on a broken rangefinder. A moth-bitten bedsheet keeps the wind out. We're not going to try to sleep here, are we? There's a greasy old spring mattress in the corner, resting on piles of soft-cover books. White linen and a pillow are visible under a worn-out caracol blanket. Kim says, someone has been squatting here. He inspects the bed. The linen is fresh, recently washed. How recently? Pain Threshold says, you force the rest of the sentence out through pain, thick as molasses, no longer able to hear yourself speak. Are my wounds hurting me? You know, officer, he looks at you with a touch of concern. You can rest here if you're feeling tired. I will keep watch. You could use some rest for what's ahead. Well, time to rest now. We'll come back. Yes, any time. If you need a rest later, it's okay by me. A speed decorum says you don't have to be a hero. Rest in the flag tower. Your damaged physique has earned its rest no matter what thoughts and dreams it may bring. Alright, I'll look around the rest of this place and then I'll... well, rest. A Books and magazines lie scattered on the floor and on a makeshift cupboard. They are not particularly well organized. Most are soft covers, serialized fantastique and detective stories from the 20s and 30s. This disparate digest includes the classic Animal Adventures. Encyclopedia says popular depictions of Man vs. Nature by amateur naturalist T. and T. Harpin, husband and wife, widely read by people from all walks of life. Who doesn't like nature? Who doesn't want to survive? Among what is mostly commercial fiction and serialized stories, you find a magazine cathodique for electrical engineering. Then it's back to pulp. Light erotica, an international thriller about circuit benders. Okay, electrical engineering. Someone's made themselves a home. The lieutenant inspects a hardcover. This is really low. Does anything stand out as unusual? Failure. Not that you can tell. This is a digest of someone who's dead bored. Most of it is for entertainment purposes, fittingly next to the radiola on the floor. Nothing out of the ordinary? Maybe it's a little old-fashioned? There's a nude mag? More than that, you can't say. Visual calculus says, the print in some of these is pretty small, though. This person has good eyesight. So you need to put into conceptualization. Maybe if you look at the rest of stuff, is this the same thing? Yeah. Maybe I'll get another glimpse. Let's look at this. Minus one composure. Army surplus winter scarf. Plus two empathy for plight of the underclass and minus two composure for sucks to be poor. This towy old scarf itches when wrapped around the neck. It has humanitarian aid written all over it. Yet you know that thousands all over the Isola are suffering the same fate as you, the fate of uncomfortable army surplus scarves. Huh. What about this? A fallen arrower shirt, plus one for hand-eye coordination. For sleeveless aim. This fallen training shirt has seen one wash too many. It retains its unusual design. Yeah, that's interesting. One sleeve short, the other long. But little of its original colors. A giant F swooshes across its chest, now in gray. Oh. Wrong key. Microgrid generator. An old cylindrical generator is nested above the ammo lift, with makeshift electrical wiring running out of its side and across the floor. The cables disappear into the wall to your right. The lieutenant puts his hand on the metal barrel, checking for warmth. It's cold now, he concludes, but someone has been maintaining it. The wiring has been repaired. Pour fuel into it? What kind of generator is this? Liquid carbon, I would imagine it takes mazut. He points to the open fuel cap on the side of the dynamo. Right, the fuel we saw outside. The kind that's favored by vagrants and fuel thieves. It's been a long winter. Long and cold. Rhetoric says, if anyone stayed here, they'd need a generator. What does this mean, a generator here? I don't know. I am not a philosopher. Conceptualization says that is his idea of a joke. I meant, why is it here? Someone with basic electrical skills has restored it in order to keep the room warm. Maybe it's the fire guy. The wind outside picks up suddenly with a faint howl. Inside it's warm. Tap the side. A hollow ring. The canister is empty. Dust falls from the generator and down into the ammo lift. Where do these wires lead? Kim looks at the wall socket. Downstairs somewhere. I don't see any reason for pouring fuel into the tank. Not at this point, anyway. There's that, figure again. Auto saving now, huh? This great blast door must weigh over 10 tons. Rust peels off it. Okay, magnesium. And $1.15 real. And another magnesium. Something beyond there. Guessing we want to rest before we do that. But then whoever's here, we'd have a they'd have a chance to. We can't go that way. Or can we? Oh, we can just go underneath it. I'm like, we warn anybody. They'd have a chance to come up and, well, Kim would be watching, but still. This hatch is jammed shut. Water rushes below, far down below. Go there. So, some kind of radio or computer. Felled insular console. Green paint flakes off the monoblock aluminum cabinet. There are rows of switches on the front panel, a frequency band, and even a keyboard. What is this then? The console of an antique computation device. The lieutenant points to the wires running into the machine. The generator upstairs with wires coming out. They terminate here. What does this console do? He inspects the dials. Urgence, overt, allumer, radio diffuse. Sounds like this device was used to control the electronics here. Maybe it still does? Interfacing says this device was used to control the electronics in the room. It could open doors, control lights, function as a radio computer. Turn emergency open. I guess things won't, nothing will work. Nothing happens. We need to restore power before using this, officer. The generator, he looks upstairs. It didn't look like there was fuel in it. That's why I'm going to put fuel in there, alright. Then he looks into the dim light to his right. We should look around outside. There are barrels all over. Maybe one of them still has something in it. Find fuel for the generator. Well, it seemed to think I already had fuel. Find fuel, then put it in the generator upstairs to power the console, to open the door. There could be fuel on the island tucked away somewhere. Explore, look around. Interfacing says the boat engine. Oh, yeah. Wait, what about this fuel I found from my MC? Oh, we found this from the car. From the crash car. He looks inside. There's barely anything left. That won't work. Or we could get some from the boat engine? But officer, he looks you in the eye. Then we would have to swim back to the mainland. Let's just look around, okay? Didn't it say we couldn't go there and back? Push light interior. Nothing happens. Radio dial. The dial slides under the glass, silently. You make out the defunct stations on the UKV frequency. The words, Feld Insular, are written on the band. Insular. The lieutenant leans in to inspect the cursive writing. This is an off-air radio computer, I believe, used for military communications. Hmm. Oh, some stuff on the step. Another magnesium. And 0.20 real. Now does that go out? I think that goes outside. I think this goes back outside, yeah. Does that open doorway? A firing slit. You can't see inside. Well, unless we encounter the killer out here. We should be okay to do this stuff and then rest. It must have been a direct hit to take out such a huge chunk. The distant sound of cargo ships' signal horns echo on the water. The ice cracks under your feet. Be careful not to fall through. Alright, let's get out of here. The winch is broken. Rust has eaten what remains of the chain. The depot that supplied this chain is long gone from the coast. Go up there. Wait. The pain in your pelvis makes you wince, then you continue. The inside of the fortress, you make out the console and the blast door. Ah, I've got some fuel there. A weathered artillery map showing coordinates in the bay of Revachol. An old medicine cabinet, newly stacked with Juramine. Huh, so I didn't need to buy this stuff. For 20. Well, now I have even more of it. Become a regular junkie. There's a rain-soaked mattress on a concrete slab, only half covered by the crumbling roof. At the head of it, double embrasures, firing slits like two eyes in the wall. A person would have hung out here. This looks like a good place to aim from. The lieutenant looks around. He steps closer with his hand on the gun. Inspect the mattress. A single person mattress. Modern. Civilian use. Brand name Marjorie. There's a fuel stain on the cover along with cigarette burns. Perception says, and an empty can of beans on the ground next to it, filled to the brim with cigarette butts. Pick one out of the can. The silhouette of a tobacco picker adorns the paper filter. The brand, Tio Materi. Encyclopedia says, contemporary Revacholians prefer Druin, a local blend from the southern islands, or Astra, the legendary cigarette from Grad. Tio Materi is favored by older men for its paper filter tips, sweet smell, and added tar. Someone's been smoking here. Kim nods. The smoker's a clean person. I didn't see any signs of smoking inside. Keeps it tidy. Prefers to come out here to smoke. Inspect the wall. Oh. There's a firing slit in the wall in front of you, like a little window. Touch the concrete first. Quite old and grimy from years without cleaning by anything other than the rain. Look through the hole. The springs screech as you lean on the mattress and crane your neck to look out. Inland Empire says, trepidation, a tingling feeling in your stomach. Oh, trajectories. A small piece of the Martinez coastline opens up in the square in front of you, like a tiny landscape painting 1 kilometer across the water. The ruins look familiar. On the left, a towering skyscraper, its top floor shaved off by artillery fire. Cape Side Apartments, Rue de Saint-Guilaine, 33A and 33B. Okay, well, we know Cape Side Apartments. On the right, the red chimney and collapsed back of the 4-story tenement in front of the Whirling and Rags, Rue de Saint-Guilaine 10, the doomed commercial area, and between the two, Whirling and Rags, that apartment. The box-shaped silhouette of the Whirling and Rags, its sloped roof, a tiny fleck of light catches your eye on the rooftop, sunlight reflecting off the upstairs window of Classier's room.